What up, dog fans? My name is Michael, and if you know me at all, you know that I love tabs. I have tabs open on my phone, on my laptop, on my desktop, just hundreds of them, thousands of them saved in my history. I like to collect websites, which are things you can do online now, guys. I went through my collection recently and pulled out all of the ones that were optical illusions. These are illusions that I've discovered in the last few months, or was reminded of in the last few months, that I wanted to remember, and I figured, hey, I'll just share them with you guys here in a dong. So let's begin. Now, you cannot talk about optical illusions on the internet without talking about Michael Bach. His website is phenomenal. It's interactive, first of all, which means that you can really play around with the parameters that make the illusion work. I want to start today with the ghostly gaze illusion. All right, now take a look at this person's face. She appears quite clearly to be looking to the left, right? But now let's turn down the blur and see what she's really looking at. Ah! Us. Pretty spooky, right? If you blur the image, she appears to be looking to the left, but take away the blur, she's looking right at you. So what's going on here? Well, this is called a hybrid image. It is constructed out of two things. One has what is called a high spatial frequency, meaning there's a lot of edges and details that are very fine. The other has a sort of low spatial frequency. It's more blobs, not a lot of edges and detail. The amount of information you get from both of those depends on how close you are to the image. If you're near an image, its high spatial frequency, the lines, the contrast, gives you a lot of information, but the big blobby vague shapes kind of just don't mean anything. But if you go far away, you lose your ability to really discern what you're getting from the fine details, and the vague ones start to paint a more clear picture. You've probably seen an even more famous version of this that involves Albert Einstein, or does it? I'm gonna take my phone out, turn on the camera and record a video and show you what happens to Albert's face as I move away. I'm sure you've seen this one before, but don't worry. Oh, that was a photo. Here comes a video. All right, so there's Albert, but now let's walk away. And the first thing we'll notice is Hannah. Hannah, say hello.
Hey.
Oh, wait a second. Where's Albert going? He's becoming Marilyn Monroe. Well, actually, the further out I go, the more like Marilyn that's gonna look. Let's see what happens if I zoom in. Ooh, it's Alberto again. That's not his name, Alberto. But if I come in close, Einstein appears again. This works in the same way that the ghostly gaze illusion works. Here's a slightly different version, but it's broken down the two images. We have a high spatial frequency image of Albert Einstein, which means lots of fine details, edges, high contrast, and then we have a very blobby, soft, not a lot of sharp detail image of Marilyn Monroe. Up close, an image like this of Marilyn Monroe is hard to decipher. It's hard to really figure out. But the detail in Albert Einstein's face is easy to see. As we move further away, the fine details get lost, we lose Albert, and the blobby, vague shapes start to mean something to us, and Marilyn emerges. Pretty awesome. Now, I've linked papers down below that explain this in more detail. A lot of this work has been pioneered by Aude Olivia. I highly suggest reading those. Obviously, what I love about Michael Bach's website is the fact that the illusions are interactive. You've probably seen this ambiguous ballerina dancer before. The ambiguity lies in which direction she's rotating. Is she turning clockwise or counterclockwise? Well, as soon as you look, your brain makes a guess, and it's often hard to switch and see it from the other perspective. But have a few friends come over, and you might be surprised that they believe she's moving in a different way. This often leads to arguments over what the figure is really doing. But Michael Bach's website allows you to more easily flip between both directions of rotation by putting eyeballs on the figure. For instance, right now I think that she appears to be moving counterclockwise if seen from above, so let me hit clockwise. Ooh, now the eyes help it reverse and now she's moving clockwise from above for me. Very, very cool. But now let's talk about the Thatcher illusion. Right now you probably already think that the face looks a little bit weird. Well, if you turn it upside down, you'll see that it is actually really weird. When a face is upside down, all of the cognitive tools we have for analyzing how it looks and what it's doing, well, they're not as great at doing their job. But enough about faces, let's talk about color. The Exploratorium has a fantastic website full of interactive exhibits. This one I just discovered this morning, actually. It's a fading dot illusion. You've got a green blob with a littler blue blob in the middle. Now, it's very important for this illusion to work that you stare at that blue dot and don't move your eyes. Really, just keep your eyes as still as possible and the blue dot will disappear until you move your eyes. The very second you move your eyes, it'll pop back into frame. Now, some people find it easier to just look at the edge of the square, keeping their eyes completely still until the blue goes away. But the second you move your eyes towards anything, the blue dot appears. That's because when your eyes move, they collect new information, and the blue dot, which was kind of forgotten as being not important, comes right back in because it is now falling onto new cells in your retina. This illusion came from Reddit, and I love it. We've got dots that are popping in and out of existence. The question is, do you, and I'm seriously asking you this, do you think that the motion illusion created here is of two dots going up and down, or of two dots going side to side? Or is it dots moving clockwise or counterclockwise? If you try really hard, you can actually flip your perspective just with your own will. Oh yeah, I just did it. Now I'm seeing them going back and forth. Now what's really interesting is that if you slow down the frame rate of this animation, it becomes even easier to flip between the different perspectives. The creator of the GIF luckily provided one that moves much slower, and here, I find it incredibly easy to choose exactly what I want the dots to be doing for me. When it's moving faster, I honestly cannot picture them moving in any kind of rotationally clockwise or counterclockwise way, but when they're slow, geez, I can just at will, at the very moment I decide I want to see it, see the motion that I want to see. Now let's talk about hinged tessellations. A tessellation is a tiling of figures that can cover a plane indefinitely, but a hinged tessellation is one in which the actual tiles can rotate and lock back into a new position. So here is what I love about this site by Al Grant. Not only do you learn about tilings and tessellations, but you also learn about how they can be hinged, and there's even a hinged tessellation generator. I can choose between trapezoid and cyclic. Let's just do trapezoid, well, let's do cyclic first. A cyclic quadrilateral is one whose points all lie on a circle, and I can choose where I put them. With a square, the result is quite trivial, but you can choose all kinds of nutty shapes. And then once you're happy with what you've got, go ahead and hinge them, and look, you have created a hinged tessellation. Great job. Brilliant.org made this episode possible, and I love them. They are right in line with what Vsauce stands for, learning and asking questions. On the site, you can run through courses that quiz you, and you might not get them all right. I certainly don't, but by getting questions wrong, I think you learn more. So let's just dive into the tessellations page. You can learn about them. Now here we have a question. If extended to cover the plane, which of the patterns below is a regular tiling? Ah, very good. Well, I think that I should have read all the information that came before this question. but I'm gonna go with D. Oh, maybe it's all of them. Incorrect. But look what it says underneath incorrect. It's okay, getting stumped is part of learning, and I totally agree. That's what I love about Brilliant.org. Also, we are offering a special deal. The first 36 people to sign up to Brilliant.org using the link below will get 20% off their annual subscription. So, check that out. Thank you for supporting Vsauce. Thank you for supporting Dong. And as always, thanks for watching.